J Street Books and Harper Audio present Your Pocket Therapist, written and read by Dr. Annie Zimmerman. Preface. All patient stories are fiction. There is no perfect term for someone who comes to therapy. I find the word client transactional and impersonal, so I prefer to use patient, as it implies a duty of care and a sense of being looked after, which feels important to me. For ease, then, I will use patient throughout. Introduction. I'm sitting on a sofa in a warmly lit room, looking across to a wise face with inquisitive eyes. Everything is about to change. I fidget in the chair, as nervous as I would be before a first date. Just not the kind of date you sneakily text your friends about when they've gone to the bathroom. No one knows I'm here, actually. There's a sort of shame in telling people, as if they might think I'm crazy or broken for being here. I'm not here because I've had a mental breakdown. Actually, I'm pretty sure my mental health is fine. If I'm honest, I'm not sure why I'm here. All I know is that I'm suffering, and I don't know what else to try. I can't stop eating. No matter what diet I try, what new type of exercise I take up, or food group I attempt to cut out, I'm stuffing my face until my belly hurts every single day. I eat in a frenzy until I feel sick, comatose on the sofa, barely present. I feel sluggish and ugly and miserable. Honestly, I don't think therapy is going to help at all. I'm just desperate. I've tried everything. I've trawled through Google, downloaded a mindfulness app, started yoga, thought positively, wrote in a gratitude journal, worked harder to distract myself, talked exclusively about food, stopped talking about food completely. I've given up sugar, written notes of warning to myself, kept chocolate out of the house, skipped meals out with friends, counted to 10, counted to 100, had 3 meals a day, 5 meals, no meals. Sometimes things helped a little, but the problem always came back. I have no idea why I'm struggling. I just know that I can't stop. I look up at this woman, who has listened to me ramble on about myself for an hour, and ask, "So, what on earth is wrong with me?" "It sounds like you're in a lot of pain," she says. "Let's try to work it out together." We agree to meet once a week, and I leave feeling unsure and skeptical that this will help. But for the first time in a long time, I have a tiny glimmer of hope that things might get better. Fast forward a few months, and I find myself struggling to speak. My eyes are full. My body screams at me not to let her see me cry, but I breathe through the pain and let a tear fall. I look up to check she's not annoyed. She nods encouragingly. I am talking about something from my past that I've never told anyone before. I was 7 and being shouted at for a reason I didn't quite understand. I went to the cupboard afterwards to make myself feel better. This was the first time I learned to use food to comfort myself. We talk, over many months, about everything other than food. It turns out that the reasons I started therapy have absolutely nothing to do with the things I end up talking about. I talk about my parents, about my sister, boyfriends, the mean girls at school. I talk about my desires, the things I'm afraid of, how I feel about myself. Yet somehow, without ever really talking about food, the problem shifts. It isn't just talking. I'm also crying. I'm angry, jealous, ashamed, humiliated, lonely, and deeply, deeply sad. Before this, I would have said I was fine, generally a happy person. Now I realize I'm full of feeling. Afterwards, I leave, and the familiar urge to eat fills me. In the cupboard, I grab my go-to chocolate biscuits and then stop myself. Try to notice what's going on in your body, I hear my therapist saying. There's a twinge of sadness. I stay with it for a moment and my eyes fill. I blink out a tear, then another. My body takes me to bed and now I'm weeping. It feels good, like a cathartic release. After a few minutes, my tears dry and I feel vulnerable, but a little better. I did not eat. The biscuits remain in the cupboard, untouched. A smile fills my face. There is nothing wrong with me. I am just very sad and angry, and the eating has been keeping all that pain down. As I lie in bed, euphoria floods me. I thought it was the eating that was wrong with me, but I realized the eating was trying to make me feel better. The only thing that was wrong with me was that I didn't yet know what was going on emotionally for me under the surface. That's when I realized that most of us don't have a clue why we are suffering. Most of our psychological problems are an attempt to cope with pain. The problems create a new kind of difficulty in our lives, but the initial root of the problem might be entirely unrelated. This wasn't the end of the binge eating, but it was the start of the end. And, several years of hard work later, I can proudly say that it's a problem that rarely rears its ugly head. Now, when it does, I understand that it's a signal of a deeper issue. In those moments, I allow myself to look under the surface with the same compassion my therapist showed me, and it goes away once more. This groundbreaking realization motivated me to become a psychotherapist. Every woman in my family is a therapist. Every single one. My mother is a therapist. My sister is a therapist. All four of my aunties are therapists. My grandma was one of the first women to study psychology at university in the UK. It's safe to say I've been raised in a cult of therapy. So it's no wonder I ended up completing a PhD in psychology and going on to train to become a psychotherapist. It's literally in my blood. While this has at times been extremely irritating and makes family gatherings pretty heavy going, it's also given me a love and appreciation for the human condition and a solid foundation of understanding about mental health and the way therapy works. Yet still, it was only in going through therapy and becoming a therapist myself that I came to understand that fundamental point. Most of us have no idea what the real problem is. In modern Western culture, we tend to believe that our conscious mind is in the driving seat. In reality, however, it's our unconscious mind that runs the show. It determines how we react to things, why we're anxious, why we procrastinate, why we prefer men who treat us badly, why girls coming on too strong freaks us out, why we're driven at work, why we can't sleep, why we're a supportive friend, why we stuff ourselves with food even though we're full, why we think everyone hates us, why we think, feel, and do anything. Sigmund Freud described the mind as an iceberg. The conscious mind is the 10% we see, but underneath, there's another 90% of the iceberg, which is our unconscious. And yes, Freud was a little problematic, sex-obsessed, and used to take his patients on holiday. Weird, right? But some of his ideas were rather brilliant and still hold up today. So many of us walk around with these big issues we can't seem to solve because we have no idea where they're coming from. In my practice, I see many people who are struggling. They know things aren't going as well as they'd like, they know they're grappling with certain issues, and they know they want things to change. What they don't understand is why or what to do about it. What I tell my patients, and what's essential for you to understand, is that you cannot change unless you get to the root of your problems. The things we think are the problems are often not the problems themselves. Food was a coping mechanism I'd learned to make me feel better. It numbed me from deeper emotions that I wasn't even aware of. Food, in a counterintuitive way, was a solution. For others, the solution might be different things: relationships, substances, work, self-criticism, anxiety, depression. Your problems are signposts that something is going on underneath. They are the tip of the iceberg. The tools people learn in therapy, and that you will learn in this audiobook, help you take a look inside to see what's going on below the surface of the water. There's nothing that gives me more pleasure than seeing one of my patients have a moment of revelation in which they realize something they've never made sense of before. Or a therapiphany, as I like to call it. Sometimes these aha moments are a relief. Often they are painful, but they are always necessary for deep transformation to occur. Desperate to bring the life-changing insights that people learn in therapy outside of the therapy room, I sought to distill complex psychological concepts into simple and digestible posts on social media. Within a matter of months, my small group of followers became hundreds of thousands of people. I couldn't believe how much my posts were resonating with people. What this shows me is that people are hungry for depth and to really understand themselves. There is a growing movement, especially among young people, to engage on a more profound level with our mental health, and a quiet revolution leading us away from oversimplification towards the pursuit of true self-awareness. People are yearning for answers. This audiobook will provide the depth we're craving by answering the questions people are longing to unpick, by summarizing the fundamentals of our psychology and relationships. People come to therapy for all kinds of reasons, but the thing they all have in common is that they want something in their lives to change. There might be hundreds of different problems that people want to address, but fundamentally, they feel stuck and want their life to improve. Part of what keeps us stuck is that we're asking ourselves the wrong questions. Questions that prevent us from moving forward. One of the first things they teach you in therapy school is that you don't have a magic pill or simple answer that can just take away someone's problems. Trust me, if I had a magic wand, I would use it. What I can do is help people to ask different kinds of questions, which get underneath the tip of the iceberg. And they're the questions I'm going to ask you in this audiobook. It's not a substitute for therapy, but it is going to arm you with the tools to gain self-knowledge so you can observe and learn about yourself. When you understand your reactions and behaviors, you give yourself a choice and power over your decisions. This is the book I wish everyone would read or listen to before starting therapy or any healing journey. It's the book I wish I'd had before I started. Each chapter will answer the questions I get asked the most by my patients and people online. It will be full of tips, stories, exercises, and lessons in manageable, bite-sized pieces that will help to explain complex and otherwise inaccessible theory on relationships, how to become more self-aware, how to feel better, and how to improve your life. Because while therapy can be hugely transformative, we are really the masters of our own mind. And the more we empower ourselves with knowledge, the more successful our healing is likely to be. There are 5 key steps in my process to understanding your emotions and moving past your suffering. Number 1, get curious. Recognize what the problem is, that it's signposting a deeper issue underneath, and start thinking about what that might be. When did the issue first develop? What role might it be serving? Think about how this shows up in your relationships and any patterns you've observed that keep cropping up. Number 2, understand. Go deep into your past experiences, becoming more aware of what the root of the problem might be and why it is there. Number 3, feel. Experience the emotions that are being kept down. We are all very talented at avoiding things we don't want to face, even without realizing. Number four, act. Turn this new awareness into action to make different choices. And number five, repeat. Notice when these patterns reoccur.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.